I done had enough of it already. Let's open with a word of prayer, please. Lord, accept our prayers and our worships in the spirit that is given as an honor to your kingdom, as you've provided everything for us, and we deserve nothing. Please accept our prayers at the highest order. Bless those who are here today, and give a special blessing to those who are not here today, that they may be well and come back with us next week. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And do our pledges now. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for which Jesus stands, one brotherhood, united all Christians in service and in love. Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word, and will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not be served to my heart. American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please remain standing as our praise team comes.
To see myself.
Before I get started, I'm going to do my little mini sermon. We're discussing in I see everybody in the class, the persecution of Paul and how he went through trials and tribulations. And I was reading something the other day. What things are made of? What are we made of? You take a pan of boiling water. You put a potato in it and an egg in it. What does a potato do? It gets just soft, and if you cook it enough, it just withers away. But an egg gets harder and harder and harder. Same water, same pan, same stove. When the heat is on, and I think it's coming, what are we going to do? Are we going to wither away, or are we going to get strong? We must get strong. That's the only way we can do. Ask the Lord to help us, and He will help us get strong. All right. We have a few announcements. The Concerned Women of America is Tuesday night. That's for men, too. We encourage you to come, 6 o'clock. Bible study we probably won't, no Bible study. We're just going to do the Concerned Women that night. Praise team will practice at 6:30 on Wednesday. Easter egg hunt, the 3rd of April. Lunch will be provided for all, and all are welcome to attend. Operation Food and Friendship Program is looking for support. Provide healthy snacks for families. Donations collected up here and downstairs. Corns for Christ for March, Meals on Wheels. Corns for Christ in February, Helping Hands. Does anybody have an address for that? That's not good. We'll try to find one. We've lost that somewhere. Next Sunday, baked potato and salad bar. Sign up today. Don't just show up because you won't get anything to eat. They're not going to fix any extra. Okay? I have been told that. Please sign up today. It ought to be good. Good. Senior luncheon the 23rd at 12 o'clock. The 27th, we're going to have special music from Liberty University coming to praise God. That was Luke and Kaylee. It's a lot of bluegrass, is that right?
They call it bluegrass praise. I don't know if I've ever heard that.
There's a play dirt side. We said last week we were going to take up money for the Slavic ministries. Donna announced that, and I forgot it, of course. But if you brought a donation, we're going to take up donations. Just leave it in that play dirt there, and it'll be out there next Sunday also. Birthdays, Melody, happy birthday. 21. All right, that's your heart. Thomas Jones, if somebody sees him, tell him happy birthday from Bethel Church. Anniversaries, Bob and Jenna Turner. We need to send them some cards. Tell them how much we miss them. They were an integral part of this church.
Amen.
Card of the week, we go have Garry. He's here. He did good. They didn't find anything. I knew they wouldn't. Because they were looking. Jay, my son Jay was supposed to be operated on this week, but they put it off for a while. His lungs capacity is not, they had to check that first. Do I have any prayer requests this morning?
Sit down and we'll talk.
Yeah, we need to pray for Betty as she's going through these trials with her mother. Donald's going through it with her mother. Any praises? Nothing good happened this week? Yeah, we did get some rain, and
teachers don't have to wear masks.
Teachers don't have to wear masks. Yeah. I did get a thank you note from Central Middle School. Thank you for the monetary donation and or the food donation. Everything that you're doing for the community with sincerity, and thank you from Central Middle School, Nadine Pinnell, coordinator. So our little outreach in the school is working. It's working, and we've planned to continue that. Any other? I ask that you continue to pray for Jay and Kenneth. Still hanging on, and his brother Timmy was in the hospital with double pneumonia, but he's back out now. Garry Walker's daughter, Lindsay. Any others? Oh, Jonathan Moore had a heart attack, but I think he's doing better. Is that right? He put in a couple of stents. He's doing better. That's London David Moore's son. I would like to thank Haywood and Gwen. These beautiful flowers up here, they're really, really nice. Anybody else? George, would you pray for us, please? Offertory hymn, our praise team will come and lead us.
Thank you. I'll give him all the honor, give him all the glory, for he deserves it all. So I won't halfway praise him, I won't halfway lift him up. With all that is within me, I will bless his holy name. So I won't halfway praise him, I won't halfway lift him up. With all that is within me, I will bless his holy
name. God is good. All the time. Y'all got to forgive me. Y'all know I'm ADD. I got to close that. It's just one of them things that about drives me crazy. But anyhow, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. It is good to be in the house of God. It really is. And you know, I feel like I am at an old-time Baptist church. Back in the 1800s, early 1900s, Baptist church, you know how Baptists got to sitting on the back rows? I'm serious. This is not a joke. Some people think I tell too many jokes, but this is serious. Baptists always sit on the back row, on the back of the church. And because a lot of times in the communities, people didn't know who people were, and the deacons or the greeters or the ushers knew that if... and a lot of times the pastors were itinerant. They would go over around. You know anything about an itinerant pastor? When's the last time you saw Robert? Been forever. Huh? But anyway, praise God. Thank you. He's doing what God called him to do. But anyway, a lot of times the pastor would come in and he didn't know a lot of who the people were. And the deacons or the ushers knew that if it was somebody we did not know, we did not know who they were, or we didn't know what their spiritual conditions were, they were to bring them down front. That was a signal to the pastor or to the guest speaker that these people, we don't know what their spiritual, everybody in the back, we know who they are. We know they made a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So I feel a little bit like that. You know, y'all okay though. I know who y'all are. You know, over the last several weeks, talked about God's love story. God's love story. Hey, you know, God's love story, and God loved us so much. But you know, sometimes I think that I went through so many things, and we'll review just a little bit in a second. We think love. You know, love is, you know, my mama used to drag me up. She said, "I love you, boy, if you can get a whipping." You know, love is not always giving somebody everything they want. Love, God's love story. Then, you know, the problem is never the problem. The problem is always much deeper. When you get down to the bottom line, the problem is always much deeper. And a lot of times people don't know that they got a problem. I went to the East Coast Men's Bible Conference down in Rocky Mount Friday and Saturday. And in fact, one of the speakers was from Las Vegas. He's from Alabama through Tennessee, through Georgia, and into Las Vegas. And he said, you know, I didn't realize this, but it, one of the greatest blessings of pastoring or planting a church in Las Vegas, you don't have to convince anybody out there they're lost. They know it. He said, you know, sometimes a lot of times you got to get somebody lost before you can get them saved. I mean, they don't know they're lost. He said, everybody in Las Vegas that lives out there, they know they're sinners if they're not Christians. You know, I didn't have a whole lot of problem with that in the jails. I mean, the guys in jail, they never wanted to argue with me whether they were a sinner or not, or whether they needed Jesus Christ. They knew who they were. The problem is never the problem. You know, over in the book of 1 Thessalonians, we're going to get to the title here in just a second, chapter 5 and verses 1 through 28. You know, we talked about that right there. We talked about, you know, who we are at our core. And sometimes we got to dig pretty deep to get there. Last week, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Are we seeking God? Are we seeking God in our lives and for our loved ones? Y'all have to forgive me. Sometimes I've been told by several people in my family that I'm too hard on my kids. I'm a little hard on my grandkids. You know why I'm hard on them? Because I love them. I love them. I love them. I love my grandkids with everything in the world. And I know that none of y'all ain't got no dumb, stupid grandkids, but I do. I mean, they do some of the... Of course, I've never done any dumb stuff. Just a second, let me get down here. Lord, forgive me, Jesus. I was ranting and railing one time about one of my son-in-laws, telling him about how dumb he was. And somebody looked over at me and said, well, at least he ain't in jail. You know who they were talking about? Me. at the same age he was. The problem is never the problem. God loves us. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. But you know, there's so many things in this world that we don't know anymore because the Church of Jesus Christ doesn't teach it, evidently. You know, we don't teach, they don't teach civics in school anymore. Somebody told me they didn't teach history back any further back than the Civil War. Is that true? Okay, maybe it's not here, but it was in another state, somebody was saying that. I don't know if that's true or not. The border. We don't know what a border is. We don't know what a citizen is. We don't know what a gender is. We don't know what a criminal is. Do we know what communism is anymore? I mean, really and truly, there's a whole lot of young people out here flat do not know what communism is. Ever since the Berlin Wall fell and the Soviet Union disappeared, do they really know at a core? You know, communism on paper looks real good. I mean, on paper, it looks real good. But in reality, it is a disaster. Socialism. You know, Nikita Khrushchev said in 1959, he took a shoe off him, pounded. Your children will live under communism. I'm afraid that old man might be right, because the children don't even know what fascism is anymore. Dictatorship. Do we really know? Do we teach that? Or do we just say, well, we assume everybody knows? That is one of the biggest problems that we face today. Do we hate our children so much that we won't teach them? That we won't teach them. We can't depend on somebody else to do the teaching. We've got to know. I got to know that I know that I know that I know where they're at. So does the church even know what marriage is anymore? Family, heaven, hell, salvation, sin. What is sin? What is sin? You know, a lot of people say, well, it's not against the law. I've actually had people tell me this. It's not against the law. What's that got to do with anything? What's that got to do with sin? Ain't got nothing to do with sin. Repentance. Love. Do we really love? Because we don't teach them. You know, the Church of Jesus Christ made a real serious... There was a thing called, back in the late 70s, early 80s, they called the seeker-sensitive movement. You ever heard of the seeker-sensitive movement? Seeker-sensitive was, we go out here and round all these people up. We just want to get them down here, and we're going to get them in the door. We're going to get them in the door, and we're going to love on them till they get saved. Now, we're not going to tell somebody that they're sinning, that they're sin. We're caught by that because seeker-sensitive, we just going to love people. So we can't hurt anybody's feelings. You know, sometimes feelings got to get hurt. Sometimes feelings have to get hurt. You know, I've actually got people, you see it on TV and on the movies and stuff. There's a lot of people think that love, I don't know where they, you know, now, pardon me, I'm not trying to go anywhere, but I got to say this way, this way. Everybody, people say, well, you know, we're just going to make love. No, you're not. That's sex. That ain't love. They ain't got nothing to do with nothing there. Love. What is love? Do we really get down and study and want to look at what love is? These are things that the church has got to take care of. We got to teach. We got to understand who's what. You know, the pastor of a church has a flock. Pastor of a church has a flock. And sometimes when the pastor comes in, you know, there's some sheep in there. There's some sheep in there that, they're not lambs, and they're not part of the flock. And the old billy goat done snuck in over there somewhere. Sometimes you got to stop and say, you know what, I want people to come. I want in my flock. And I've said this several times, and I don't ever get upset when lost people act like lost people. Don't ever get upset if a dog acts like a dog. You know, when somebody puts up a sign, beware of dog, he will bite. You know what? I take that literally. And y'all ever been bit? If a cow, don't get upset if a cow acts like a cow, because a cow's a cow. If I see a bear, I see the bear. I know what a bear going to do. Bear going to bite me. Have me for lunch. Now, he may have diarrhea for 2 or 3 weeks if he eats me, but, you know, that's the way it goes. With lost people, I want to go out and talk to them about Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you, lost people, I do not want in my house. In my house. I don't. I want, they can come in and they can fellowship with me. They can talk with me. I love... Now, I dog this old boy. I love my grandson. See, I don't dog y'all folks half as bad as I dog mine. I love my grandson, Riley. Riley is living with his girlfriend down in North Carolina. He knows Papa don't approve of it. And I got some kinfolk that tell me Riley needs to get married. Now, Riley don't need to get married. Riley needs to get saved. Riley's lost as Hogan's goat. He's lost. Because if you get married and you ain't saved, All you've done is just add another offense to what God ordained. God ordained marriage. And I'm in enough trouble with God. I'm in enough trouble with God. I got to keep very short accounts. Very, very short accounts. Folks, we got to begin to teach and talk and do the things. You know what? I've had people tell me so many times over my lifetime, you know a man or a woman by their friends or by the company they keep. You know, you can know a whole lot more about somebody by the people that don't like them. There's some people in this world that if I found out they liked me, I would be upset. I would be upset if I found out they liked me. That would mean they saw something in me that they thought was... There's some people out here living so far out here in sin that if I found out they liked me, I would say, you know what? I got to go over there and talk to them about their sin. Because somebody ain't. That means, see, so many people that like you, they want to come in and they say, well, I want to hang with him because, well, they do the same thing I do. They do the same thing I do. We normally, you know, birds of a feather do flock together. And if people see me doing the same thing they're doing, they see me hanging with them too much, they're going to say, well, he approves or he's doing this. No. I want people to know who I am and what I am. Over in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 24. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24. He that spareth his rod hateth his son. He that spareth his rod hateth his son. But he that loveth him chasteth him betimes. Early. Betimes means early. He that spareth his rod hateth his son. But he that loveth him chasteth him betimes. Oh Lord, help us to look into your word, to gain some insight. God, help us to understand. Lord, I don't hate my kids. I love them. I love them as much as the air I'm breathing. I love my grandkids with as much air as I'm breathing. I love them. I love them with everything I got. Oh Lord, the last time I was down there around them, All of them came running. Had about 8 or 9 of them hanging off of me when I got, thank you, Jesus. But when they're doing wrong, they know Papa ain't going to approve of it. Oh, God, help us. Give us strength, God. Help us to be the men and women of God that you would have us to be. Lord, I want my kids to know that I love them. I love them. Lord, let it not ever be said that I hate my kids. Help us, God. Amen. Over in the book of Proverbs, chapter 19. Proverbs, chapter 19, verse 18. Chasten thy son while there is hope. Chasten thy son while there is hope. And let not thy soul spare for his crying. Spare for his crying. Man, ain't nobody in the world cry like me. Man, I could cry with the best of them. It is beyond my comprehension. So if you start crying and hollering, they'll stop sooner. Help me. Hear counsel. Verse 19. A man of great wrath shall suffer punishment. For if thou deliver him, yet thou must do it again. That means if you cover up and 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 you don't chasten him and you get him out of trouble, you're going to do it again and again and again. I'm going to tell y'all something. I love my mama. I loved her with everything I had. But mama gave me a real good lecture when I was about 13, 14 years old. I was really straying out. And she said, "Son, I'm going to tell y'all something. I'll tell you how old I am." She said, "Son, if you ever get locked up, you wasting your dime if you call me to come get you out." And you know what? Mama told the truth. I knew better. I knew better than to use my one phone call calling her. Because that was going to hit a deaf ear. That was going to hit a deaf ear. I got locked up one time. Jacksonville, Alabama. Me and a bunch of other boys out like food. I never will forget this. On Sunday morning, we woke up. We was all hungover and everything else. And one of the jailers come up and he looked over at one of my friends. His name was Willard Norton. He said, jailer hollered down there and said, "Hey, Norton, get up. You're getting out." And Willard looked up over at him. He said, "Who's down there? Come get me out." He said, "Your mama." He said, "I ain't going. I ain't going. I'm serious." And the jailer came in and unlocked the door. He said, "You got to come out. We're going to get you out." He said, "Willard, big old boy. He's a big old boy." He said, "Well, you're going to have a fight." He said, "I ain't going down there till you make her leave." He said, "You don't understand. It's going to be a scene, a bad scene." Because Hazel Norton did not play. Whew, we laughed because we could see out the window. The jailer went down and said, "You got to go down into the block." As soon as Willard hit that front door, he took off running. Bam! He took off running. He was running like a dog that had poured some turpentine on him. And I laughed. But you know what? He knew he was fixing to get chastened. He was fixing to get chastened by his mama. Oh, my goodness. "Hear counsel and receive instruction that thou mayest be wise." See, that's what this is all about. In the latter end, we got to teach. We got to begin to stop and say, you know what? I want all of you to be wise. I want my children, I want my grandkids to be wise. I want them to be able to get into the Word of God, and to be wise young men and wise young women. And I'm making some headway with a bunch of them, but my oldest daughter's 4. I mean, I'm having trouble with some of them, all but one. I mean, I want them to be wise. But see, the foundation wasn't put in there, was not put in early in life. It needs to be put in early. Y'all want your grandkids and your kids to be wise? Y'all want your grandkids and be wise? I mean, wise people. It says, "There are many devices in a man's heart," in verse 21. "There are many devices in a man's heart, nevertheless, the counsel of God shall stand." Shall stand. "The desire of a man is his kindness, and a poor is better than a liar. The fear of the Lord tendeth life, and he that hath it shall abide safely. He shall not be visited of evil. A slothful man is lazy, hideth his hand in his bosom, and will not so much as bring it to his mouth again. Smite a scorner. Smite a scorner, and the simple will behave, beware, and reprove one that hath understanding, and he will understand knowledge." You know, one of the reasons that I'm tell you, it killed my daddy, killed my twin brother. It really helped. It was the main reason to kill my baby girl. Verse 20 in Burford Proverbs. Why I hate alcohol so bad. "Wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging. And whosoever is deceived, whoever is deceived thereby, is not wise." Wise. Every real dumb thing, and I've done a lot of dumb things, but every real dumb thing I ever did in my life, I did while I was drinking. I tell people all the time, the reason I had to stop drinking is because I found out I could make enough stupid decisions without any help. But see, I want my children to be wise. Discipline. Discipline is the gateway to knowledge. Annie Sullivan was Helen Keller's teacher. And Helen Keller, she was deaf and mute and blind, and her family couldn't do anything with her. And they hired Annie Sullivan to come teach her, to be her caretaker. But Annie Sullivan had graduated from a college, and they thought, well, maybe this will help her. This will help. and Annie got down there, and the family was getting ready to fire Annie Sullivan. Getting ready to fire her because they said she was so mean to Helen. Helen, she's being mean to Helen. But Annie began to make a breakthrough, and she wrote to her professor back up in Massachusetts, and she said, "I have discovered that the gateway to knowledge is discipline." Discipline. Discipline. Gateway to knowledge is discipline. Folks, we've got to learn what discipline is. The dictionary definition, discipline, is action or inaction that is regulated to be in accordance with a particular system of governance. Particular system of governance. You know, no organization, whether it be the country, our country, the things we forgot that made us great, whether it be the country, whether it be a business, whether it be whatever it is any stronger than its ability to discipline its members. If there is no discipline, there is no consequences for breaking the rules, that system will fail. It takes discipline to teach and learn. Don't want to pick on her, but she's just the closest. Got to have a little discipline in your classroom, don't you? Two or three of them, if you could get rid of them, the class would be a whole lot better, wouldn't it? Don't shake your head. Don't shake your head. But you know, sometimes you got two or three of them that just need to be sent out for one of those things I said a couple of weeks ago. Just need to be sent out. But you can't do that no more, can you? Discipline. We got to have some discipline. In order to learn, you got to know that there are consequences for your actions. But a lot of us don't know that. You know, over in the book of James is my favorite book. You'll never have to ask that question again, what's your favorite book? Over in the book of James chapter 1, verse 8. James chapter 1, verse 8. A double-minded man is unstable in all. I love that word, all. A double-minded, you know, that's one person that says one thing over here, but does something over here. A double-minded man is unstable. You know what's wrong with our nation? There ain't no stability. Nobody knows what's going on. I mean, nobody knows what's happening. Any consequences of crossing the border down there? No, we're going to give you everything you want. Any consequences for what's going on over in Europe? Right? No. There's no discipline, no true guidance in anything or so many things that we do. Folks, I got a lot of problems in my life. I do. I have to keep real short accounts with God. I do. But you know what my biggest sin is? I'm going to tell y'all what my biggest sin in my life is today. Found in James. James is my favorite book of the Bible. James chapter 4. The very last verse in that right there. Therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doth it not, to him it is what? There's a lot of times. See, there's sins of omission and sins of commission. So many times I know I'm supposed to go do something for somebody that's good. Now it may be to take some mercurochrome and some methylate and pour it on something, but that's good. I know methylate and mercurochrome are good. Amen? You know how I know that? Because my mama bought it by the gallon. And when we got hurt, mama stuck all the dirt off of it. I mean, didn't go wash it. She just knocked the dirt and the gravel off of it and poured on me. Just poured on you. And then you take off running. I know it's good. Sometimes to do good, you got to do good by saying, you know what? There's a little alcohol need to be poured on. A little methylate, a little mercurochrome got to be put on that right there. Doing good. See, I want to do good. But so many times I don't. Because I say, well, if I do that, that's just going to stir up a bunch of stuff. Sometimes stuff just needs to be stirred up. Sometimes it just needs to be. Because see, we've got too many, I'm going to use the churches again. We've got too many seeker-sensitive churches. I'm going to tell you, Satan has been so wonderful, so wonderful, so wonderful in the seminaries. And you know, Satan will you think he's over here, but he's over here. Always look, you see the right hand shaking, look what the left hand's doing. See, so all these good seminary professors, and they do a great, I mean, they do a good job of teaching stuff. I don't got no problem with that. But they tell these young men, you can't go do anything till you have your doctorate. Now you need to stay right here and get your doctorate. The average young man, that's why a lot of these churches down here, especially in the country, can't find a pastor. The average young man comes out of school with about $120,000 worth of student loans. Love them things, don't you? We all love student loans. Student loans, anybody's ever had one. The average young man that wants to be a pastor comes out of church and he's got $120,000 worth of debt here. Most of them, this is average. This is actual statistics. Come out with two kids, wife and two kids. That's why Liberty tells the pastor, or tell if you went to Liberty right now and looked for a pastor to come into this church, they would tell you you've got to start them at a minimum of $80,000, but it's better to start them at $180,000 minimum. That's if you're gonna get a young man with a doctorate degree with a wife and two kids. You got to start them at 80. That's what I was helping Spring Creek. That's exactly what they told them. But see, you know what? See, that young pastor knows that not only is this a ministry for him, this is a job. It's a job. See, we got to be seeker sensitive. We got to get people in the church. We got to get people. I ain't gonna say that like a lot of pastors say it. We got to put people in the church so they'll put that number right there. They'll put that number. So we got to have enough money to pay my salary. And say, I've actually had a bunch. I can't even tell you the number. A pastor's tell me, well, I can't take that stand right there. Can't take that stand right there. Because if I did, a couple of my biggest givers would leave and they couldn't pay my bills. Couldn't pay my paycheck. And y'all, I ain't as bad as old John Rollins. Old John Rollins used to cuss a lot, and I do every now and then. Got to go down there a minute. That man, that pastor, is not a pastor. That's not. If you're not willing to stand and trust God, can you trust God? See, it takes discipline to trust God. It takes discipline to trust God. Can we? Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, and doth it not, to him it is sin. And a lot of times, to do good, it's going to make some people mad. It's going to make some people mad if you're going to do good. But see, I love people. I love people. I don't want to see anybody go to hell. And there's a pile of people outside these doors going to hell because nobody tell them you're living in sin. Nobody tell them you're living in sin. We're okay. Well, everybody's okay. No. Everybody's okay. No, we're not. We're not okay. You shall know them by their what? By their what? I can't hear that. By their fruits. By their fruits. You shall know them. You know, you don't get good fruit from a bad tree. See, we got to have some discipline. And I'll shut up here in just a minute. I know I'm out of time. Scoot over just a little bit in James chapter 5. I'm going to start verse 13. Is any among you afflicted? See, there's a lot of people outside these doors right here that are afflicted. There's people outside these doors that are afflicted with emotional stress, mental stress, spiritual stress. There's people outside these doors with alcohol and drug problems. They're afflicted with so many things. Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders. That's why the elders of this church need to be strong men of God. That's why the deacons, the elders and the deacons, trustees. And let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess. See, we don't know how to do that anymore. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one to another, one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth for the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruits. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him. Oh my goodness. You mean we got to convert people? We got to go out. How do you convert people? You got to go out and tell them what they're doing is wrong. You're going in the wrong direction. Well, most people don't like to be told they're wrong. Any of y'all like to be told you're wrong? Y'all heard me say that? I don't like it. I don't like it at all. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his or her ways shall save a soul from death and hide a multitude of sins. Because we got to have discipline. See, we don't have discipline in how to pray. That's why we're going to have this Concerned Women for America little thing. We want to begin to teach people. We want to get down and learn how to pray. We've got to learn how to confess our sins. We've got to have some accountability partners. We learned a little bit about that at the men's conference we went to at Standing Courageous to get a battle buddy. We've got to learn how to confess and Lord, I've got to keep short accounts with God. We got to learn how to get the power of God on us. Because as Ricky well pointed out, there's some days coming. Folks, there's some days coming. We think what's happening over there. You think $4 a gallon gas is high? Hang on. Just hang on. Those days are coming. Those days are coming. If you don't think they got the power right now to shut that colonial pipeline down again, you better back up. I'm going to tell you, there's some people out there right now. We better learn how to get the power of God. We got to learn how to pray and confess. We got to learn how to love and not hate people. We got to learn how to love them. But loving them don't mean we wrap our arms around them and say, "Oh, baby, come here. I want to help you in sin." I want y'all to pray about something for me. I've shared this here before. Some of you probably don't remember. I got a brother-in-law. I know I'm going a little long. Y'all hang with me. I got a brother-in-law. He's a good man. Well, let me back up. I want to think he's a good man. He's a deacon at a Baptist church up in the Northern Neck. Deacon at the Baptist church. Several years ago, he allowed his son to move his girlfriend, his son's girlfriend, into his house. Now, our kids can go out and do all kind of things. I can't stop that. But it ain't coming to my house. And he let his son move his girlfriend into his house and live there for several years. Now everybody says, you know what the pastor said about that? Not a thing. You know why? Because my brother-in-law got a little money, and he puts a good bit of money in that church. But you know what happened to my brother-in-law's testimony in that community? You know what happened to the pastor's testimony? We got to have power. See, I told him it was wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. Well, see, people don't want to talk to me because it's wrong. It's wrong. You just want to Baptists that believe, oh, you know, people, everybody ought to get saved. Yeah, I do. Y'all love people. Y'all love enough people to tell them they're living in sin. You love them enough. Do you love your family enough to say, you love your grandkids enough? Because what I'm talking about, right, what I was just talking about, it's rampant. It's rampant across the world. It's rampant across this country. It's rampant across this state. It's rampant. And you know, if we don't tell them, We don't tell them who's going to tell them. Who's going to, you know, we're going to have to give an account. Over in the book, and I promise this right here is the last scripture. Over in the book of 1 John. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. I'm telling you, I got it. But I keep short accounts of God. And I'm going to tell you, I don't sin 3% as much as I did 40 years ago. God has been working on me hard because I judge myself. I go to that altar right there every Sunday, and I say, God, you know what I've done. I've not been doing the good that I ought to be doing. Lord, you know the thought that popped through my mind, you know this. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in it. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and the word is not in us. See, I will never tell you I'm not, because I'm not making God a liar. I'm not making God a liar. I will not make God a liar. But I'm going to tell you, private sin should be confessed privately. That's between me and God. Y'all don't know about that. Y'all don't need to know about it. Lord, if we all started confessing all our sins here, we'd be here for 40 years. But public sin. If everybody in the county knows about it, that need to be confessed publicly. How do you join this church? You come down here and you make a public profession of Jesus Christ. I would say you got to be born again. How do you get baptized? Publicly. How do you become a member of this church? Come down and say, I want to be a member of this church. I profess that I know the Lord Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. I know I've been baptized by immersion. That's the way a Baptist church does it. And I ask. You have to ask. I can't ask. I can't go out here and ask for somebody else to be saved. I can't go out here and ask somebody else to be baptized. I can't go out here and ask for somebody else to join this church. You got to do it publicly. And when you break the rules, God's rules in this church, it needs to be confessed publicly, because everybody in the county knows about it already. You ain't telling them nothing they don't already know. By not confessing that you know, all you're telling them is pride. Pride or emotion won't let me do it. Because what will they think about me? See, that ain't the question. Is what are they already thinking about you? What are they already thinking about us? If we don't keep short accounts with God. See, my testimony means something to me. I worked hard. I've worked hard to try to be what God would have me to be. How hard are we working? Do we love our children or do we hate them? I want my grandkids to say, you know what? My granddaddy might have been a little hard on me, but I know he loved me. I know he loved me. I know he loved me. He loved me enough to warn me. Do we love our kids or do we hate them? Lord, I ask you to walk with us, guide us, and strengthen us. And Lord, I pray from the depths of my heart and soul, Lord, you'll help us all. Lord, there are multitudes of lost people out here. God, that we've got to call to repentance. I can't call them because they're not going to listen to me. They'll listen to you. God, they'll listen to you through your Spirit. But working through all of us, God, we need a purified church. A purified congregation sitting right here, purified, that seeks every day to seek ye first in the kingdom of God and His righteousness. God, will we seek you? Will we seek you, God? Lord, don't let me be a stumbling block. Lord, let me be a warning post. Warning. The bridge is out down the road. If you go down that road running wide open, you're going over the cliff. The bridge is down. God, help us to warn. Lord, if there's one here today that does not know you, God, help them to make that public profession of saying, God, I'm a sinner. Well, Lord, I know you. I've been under control. I come and bring this to you. Nobody else needs to know that. God, that's between you and them. Unless it's public. And I want to restore my testimony. Lord, help us. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. The altar's open. If anybody needs to come and pray.
Shall